لله الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل إن كان آباؤكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها مساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمره صدق الله العظيم. All praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may the chastest blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon His most beloved Nabi, our leader, Hazrat Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We thank and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having granted us a heart that has been granted and planted with the seed of Iman. And now, when we do various actions, then we are watering that heart. The seed of Iman was planted on the day we were born, and the Adhan was given in our ears. So when the Adhan is given in the ears at that time, then what is being done actually is that the seed is being planted. The child does not understand anything. The child won't know what is happening. Some children, you give Adhan in their ears, they start crying. Others, they start smiling, and they start, and others, they just give a frown and say, what is happening here? But they don't understand. But through the channel of the ear, the message of Tawheed is going in. The message of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is penetrating, and it is going and finding place in the heart. So fortunate is indeed is that heart that at the time of birth, it received the seed of Iman. And thereafter the seed of Iman then develops. It depends on what kind of environment we give that child. It depends on what kind of nourishment we give that seed. If we speak about Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we do all good actions, and soon we let the child also do that good actions, and we are actually creating an environment. We know we have to have a good environment for anything to grow properly, whether it is in the fields, in the farms. The climate has to be correct. We find certain things grow somewhere and certain things don't grow elsewhere. Likewise, we find certain people, they have got atriums and they've got whatever in their homes. They have all kinds of places where they grow things, and they have to keep a certain controlled climate, so that enables the thing to grow. And over and above that, then they will throw water and they will throw fertilizer and so whatever it might be. So the more the child is kept in an environment where deen and deeni talks are taking place, where the child sees good akhlaq, good actions around it, that's a mashallah good environment. And then as the child grows up, the child is made to do various things, and you are actually developing that seed. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, without us having even asked, that we have got a heart that has got the seed of Iman in it. Now this heart here, we must remember, it belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once the seed of Iman and Tawheed has been planted in there, then we must not let anything else get in between that pollutes it. And from among the things that can pollute this particular heart, we are discussing at this point in time, is that in our interaction with human beings, we spoke about how sometimes people, they go overboard in the sense that they give too much of love, or they misplace their love, or they give priority to other people's love above Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love. And that can be very, very harmful. So last week we concluded on the aspect of love for one's wife, and we gave quite a bit of emphasis that we must make sure that we fulfill their rights and we give them their love, but then we must know where the boundaries of that particular love are. It mustn't happen that when we are giving that love, we mix up and we misprioritize, and we give their love preference over the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We even give the example of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's love for Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So nevertheless, that's a whole different discussion. How to go about in fulfilling the rights and expressing love and all the rest of that. The same thing will apply also, we must remember, to the love that we give to our children. That also must be within the ambit and under the umbrella, or within the parameters of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also given place in the place where it's supposed to have been in the first place. Because many times we find that the love for our children is such that it takes such precedence in our heart that for their happiness and for their joy and for their pleasure, we break the orders and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We gave the example last week, for example, of the Fajr Salah, where we feel so sorry for them. We don't want them to get up, you know. But we don't realize what we are doing at that point in time. So we have to be careful. And we did make mention also about the story of Hazrat Khidr alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam when they were walking. And at that point in time, Khidr alayhi salam took the little child, no, innocent little baby, was playing in the streets, and he just basically twisted his neck or whatever, and he killed him. Obviously, Musa alayhi salam was shocked, and anybody will be shocked. At how can you kill a little child like that? So Khidr alayhi salam said, you see, there are some wisdoms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which you don't know about. One of them is, and later on he told him that this particular child would have been the cause of his pious, upright parents leading to kufr. So we find that sometimes when a person is not careful and he can fall in this kind of a difficulty. So we do various things. In this day and age, it is so frightening what we do for our children. How? Because society has become, how there is entertainment and those things around. So we give them all kinds of gadgets and devices to keep them busy and to keep them out of trouble. People who don't have TV in the house, also they bring a TV in the house, they say the children go to the neighbor's house. They don't have to go to the neighbor's house to watch TV, rather they come and watch here. So what are we trying to save them from? We're trying to save them from the neighbor's house. But what are we bringing to our home? What effect we are bringing? And what the kids are being exposed to and what they are watching? What harm is that doing for the children? Today, if you look at the akhlaq and the actions of the children, you look at their attitudes and look at how they talk and how they backchat and how they do a lot of things, and we find they come from such good homes, so where they've been getting this ta'lim, this education of this kind of bad behavior. We have to ask ourselves that. So we wanted to let them go to the neighbor's house. So we brought that in the house, and then we find that now they're exposed. And we say that, you know, obviously out of love for them again. So it is said, فَرَّ مِنَ الْمَطَرْ فَقَامَ تَحْتَ الْمِيزَابِ. We took them out of the rain, but then we made them stand under the gutter. So there is more water falling there at that point in time. We have to be careful when it comes to that love. It mustn't happen that we cause more harm to them in the long run. We have to make sure that whatever we do, in whichever way it might be, we keep them on the obedience of Allah Ta'ala, and we don't let them do something that causes us to go away from the obedience of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. We're talking about that love that has now contaminated that heart. That's why in the ayat of the Quran, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, say, in the 10th part, Allah says, say, قُلْ إِن كَانَ أَبَاؤُكُمْ, that if your fathers, your children, your brothers, your wives, your families, the wealth which you have accumulated, the businesses that you are afraid are going to be destroyed, and the homes that you love so much, they make you so happy when you see them. All these things, Allah says, say, if these things are more beloved to you than Allah and His Rasul, and going out in His path, then فَتَرَبَّسُوا, then wait for the order and the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now it's like a threat, Allah ta'ala says, if you love these things more, watch out, just wait, see what's going to happen to you. فَتَرَبَّسُوا means watch out. So here we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a warning that we must not let the love of any of these things, our parents, our families, even our businesses for that matter, we have love for them, but we mustn't go and acquire it and do it in such a manner that we love it more than we love the command of Allah. Or our homes, how we put them up, or how we decorate them, or how we live in them, or what our environment, all the things with regard to our homes must not be such that it is in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So nevertheless, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a particular warning, and that is that ahabba, comes the word muhabbat, that don't let that love be much more to you than the love of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So be careful. So that if that happens, then the heart is in trouble. The heart is sick, the heart is diseased, and the heart needs to be sorted out actually. Then we have another serious kind of epidemic at this point in time, we can say, that has taken over the hearts of the people, and that is the epidemic of false love. That is love based on lust. So where a person loves another person, and this is normally over the gender border, they love someone not because they love, but because they have got that person in front of them or as their partner with whom they have got evil intentions and with whom they have got intentions of fulfilling their carnal desires. And all, why does this come about? This comes about because the heart at that point in time has got certain sicknesses like lust and passion and fulfilling of desires and so forth. So this person is in love with another person just for the sake of fulfilling his passions. If that passion is not there, if the passions are fulfilled, then that love also goes away many times. And we find the person is then, that whole love has got absolutely no, it can, that kind of love can just turn overnight like that. And we find so many times in this world, so many cases where people are supposed to have been in love and they were having the what they refer to as the best kind of love affairs, and then something just went wrong, how they turned against each other and they became such worse enemies of each other. So that love is also not something that is, in fact, there's no limit for that love. There's no place for that kind of love. And what it is normally the outward, you know, appearances of people that cause this kind of haram love to actually take root in the heart. And when that takes over, it is a serious, serious sickness. Like I said, it's an epidemic. And today it's become so difficult for people. That is why we go back to the guarding, safeguarding of the gaze. If the gaze can be at that point in time controlled, then basically we have nipped the evil in the bud. Inshallah, nothing will happen after that. Keep at all times in mind that there is all this danger lurking around there. And if I'm not careful at any time, Shaitan is going to use that opportunity, like they said, from the poisonous arrows of Shaitan. The one is this, that he lets you cast evil glances. And when a person gets trapped in this kind of a love, then you got a problem. In fact, it's not a trap. You can't even call it a trap. If you're in a trap, if you get trapped, sometimes a person gets caught in a trap because he didn't know there was a trap there. So he got trapped. This person here, he's sinking. He's thinking, he gets sunk in this kind of a sickness. And if a person is in a trap, he can still come out. But a fellow who's sinking, you know, in a quicksand, if a person gets, you really need some serious help. Someone has to come and pull you out. If you're going to try and come out of that, many times you find it's more difficult. That's why people who are afflicted with this kind of love in this sickness, it's a sickness, then they need to go to their mashayikh, they need to go to their sheikh, they need to confide in somebody who can help them to get out of it. And they go to tell that person, you know what, help me, the sheikh inshallah will put him onto a certain kind of a tartib or a certain kind of a treatment, as we can say, and ilaj, and get him out of it. He will cry for him, the sheikh will make dua for him, the sheikh will cast his spiritual attention on such a person's heart, and in a little while what will happen, this person inshallah will get away, he will get out of it. Nowadays we know we have some kind of treatments. People go for this cataract laser. What's laser? It's just something that they focus. It's a laser that is focused on the area that is affected. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given laser effect to the spiritual power of the awliya Allah. And many times they just put their tawajjuh, they just laser you with their attention. And alhamdulillah, you are sorted out. That's why they said to sit in the company of the pious people. And Allah Ta'ala give us opportunity, pious people come in our locality, we can sit in their company. And just their gaze falling on us, inshallah, it can laser a lot of fitna and a lot of evil out of our hearts. And this is a sickness that a person, like I say, gets trapped and he can lose his whole magaj. Magaj kaam nahi kare. You know, they say his head is not taking right. Why this man's head is not taking right? What happened to him? Because he fell in love with some woman who he saw, who he thought was very beautiful in his eyes. You know, we'll conclude on this here. You heard of a person in the Arab world. His name was Imr al-Qais. Imr al-Qais, I'll give his other name just now, then you know what I'm talking about. So Imr al-Qais fell in love with one woman. And this woman didn't have anything what we or anybody in that area regarded as beautiful. Neither her looks, nor her complexion, her features. There was nothing about her, you know, like to say, to write home about. But he fell in love with her. Everybody was surprised, why you got involved here? But in any case, he was madly in love with her. So there are a lot of stories written with regard to his madness over her. In fact, it is said her complexion was such that she was known as Layla. Layla means darkness of the night. And people should say, but why did he fall in love with a woman like this? So we know that in history there was an incident that took place. After Ali radiallahu anhu passed away, the Khilafat went to his son, Hazrat Hassan radiallahu anhu. And when Hazrat Hassan took over the Khilafat, then Sayyidina Amir Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala came and told him that let us reconcile and you do not take the Khilafat, rather let me take over the Khilafat. Hazrat Hassan radiallahu anhu loved peace. That's a whole different story of history. But Hazrat Hassan radiallahu ta'ala anhu handed over the Khilafat to Sayyidina Amir Muawiyah. And that's history. Now, what is that got to the story here? Hazrat Hassan radiallahu ta'ala, some people were taunting him. In fact, his own brother said, now Hussein radiallahu also told him that you shouldn't have given up. And a lot of close friends of his told him you shouldn't have given up Khilafah. But he was a man who loved peace, so he gave it up. So one day Hazrat Hassan radiallahu was walking in the street and he sees Imr al-Qais coming. So he says, Qais, what do you think? Don't you think it's a good thing I gave up the Khilafat? I gave it to Amir Muawiyah. Imr al-Qais just didn't answer. So he said, I'm talking to you, Qais. Don't you think it's a good thing that the Khilafat is given to Amir Muawiyah? Imr al-Qais says, this Khilafat, if you gave it to my Layla, it would have been better. He was so obsessed with his Layla that he can't be bothered. He doesn't know who's Amir Muawiyah. He doesn't know the seriousness of what Khilafat is. He said, leave all that. You should give it to my Layla. So Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu said him, Anta Majnoon, you Majnoon. That is where you hear the story of Layla and Majnoon. I told you his name was Imr al-Qais. Nobody knows him as Imr al-Qais. They all know him as Majnoon. Majnoon means mad. Majnoon means mad. So his name became Majnoon. Majnoon because, you know, one person can be Majnoon in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is totally obsessed in the, he's consumed by the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's one hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also says that make dhikr to such an extent that people say, you know, you're mad. This man is mad. He is mad for a good cause. But this Majnoon, he created a legacy for himself until today. He is known for a man who was in love with this particular woman. And his father told him, you know what, you really spoiled my name, you. You've got a bad reputation. You need to be sorted out. Come, let's go to Baytullah. Let's go make dua there in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's house, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes out this love from your heart for this Layla, so that you can then, you know, focus yourself and you can lose some of this insanity that you have got and this obsession for this woman here. So they went in front of the Kaaba and they both started making dua. Father's also making dua and he's also making dua. He's making loudly and he made tawbah. He said, Ilahi tubtu min kulli al-ma'asi. Oh Allah, I make tawbah from all sins. ولكن حب ليا لا توبه. But for the love of Layla, I still don't make tawbah. It was so crazy. So the father got very, very angry at him and looked at him. What dua are you making in front of the Kaaba? So he's saying, you see, this man is now mad. When a person gets consumed, even there he doesn't want to let go of the haram love. So any case, father gave him a bad, dirty look and said, what kind of a dua? So he pulled himself together. He said, Ilahi, لا تسلبني حبها ابدا ويرحم الله عبدا من قال امينا. He said, oh Allah, don't ever take out the love of Layla from my heart. And whoever is listening to my dua and they say Amin, always have mercy on that person. This is what we call, that's why they call him Majnoon. They're totally mad in the love of Layla. Like we said, you know, there's one very, very famous poem, a couplet of his. He used to walk in the city of Layla. Eh? And what he said, people should see he's hugging the walls and he's kissing the walls. And they ask him, what are you doing? He said, this is the city of Layla. This is the walls within she lives, within which she lives. So he was, you know, expression of love. That I even love the walls of the city of my beloved Layla. One day somebody saw him kissing a dog. He said, why are you kissing the dog? He said, this dog went through that gully where my Layla lives. So what we say, that this is that kind of love. If a person is not careful, I said, you don't get trapped in it. You get sucked into it. And if a person doesn't make any effort of getting out of it ASAP, and if he doesn't realize what is going on, then such a person, he is going to really, really throw his whole akhirat away. And this is one of the traps that Shaitan has actually laid for him. And he's also one of the people that he will throw his dunya away, throw his akhirat away. And he will never ever taste the sweetness of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he's blocking. He's got another kind of a temporary. One person asked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with regard to this one. There was a very light-hearted discussion taking place. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting there, and this person says, oh Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when can we say, what will be the sign that a person has got total love for the makhluq, for the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, saharul layali wa irsalul lu'la'i, that the person stays up whole night and This is the love of his dunya, of the dunya people. And he is causing pearls to flow. What is pearls? Tears of love, out of love for his beloved. Whereas the same love here, he could have stayed up at night, same thing. If he had love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he could get up in tahajjud salah, for example, and he can shed those tears. The way that is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we find that if a person is not careful with regard to this kind of love, it's not only love, it is more, we can say, lust. It is called passion, it's called nafsaniyat. And a person needs to ensure that he doesn't allow himself ever to be sucked into that. Gaze is very, very important. And also cleanliness of mind, cleanliness of heart, where shaitan would keep on coming and maybe reminding him, you know, making him look there. Shaitan pokes a person, prods him, say, look, this beautiful woman is going past. If he didn't look, shaitan will make him feel, you missed out, man. You missed out big time. You know what, you just missed out. Or shaitan will, if he saw her, shaitan will keep on coming, so, you know, make him think about that woman and then start cooking ideas in his mind to go in that direction. So we must make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us protected.